Good afternoon, everyone. My name is William Milberg. I'm Dean of the New School for Social Research. I'm very pleased to welcome you to today's lecture and to the New School, a lecture sponsored by the Janey Program in Latin American Studies at the New School for Social Research. I know everyone is very keen to get to the main event from President Dilma Rousseff. I'd like to say just three short things. We are living in an era of heightened political polarization in the United States, in Brazil, in the UK, France, Hungary, Turkey. The list goes on. It is our job as scholars and citizens to maintain as serious and civilized a discussion as possible, to avoid increased polarization that creates enemies out of our friends and fellow citizens, and that makes political progress so difficult. Brazil has a long history of such polarization and yet has found ways to bring democratic and progressive outcomes. We look in the US to Brazil for finding ways through these politically divided times. The New School is a place that prides itself in a serious, theoretically sophisticated analysis applied to the real world. This is our legacy, our proud legacy, in a rich social democratic tradition of seeking knowledge and social improvement through the iterative process of theory and application to the world. This is the 1919 tradition of Dewey and Veblen. This is the 1933 tradition of Hans Speier, Frieda Wunderlich, and Hannah Arendt. And this is the tradition that we promote today. And I would just point out, it's promoted in particular in our Janey program in Latin American Studies. Its faculty leaders, Carlos Forment, Federico Finkelstein, the former director, both represent this great tradition. Students are attracted here from around the world because of this, to study society, ethics, and social change. And I want to thank them, especially Carlos, for his work on preparing this event and for his ongoing commitment to rigorous and engaged research. The New School is proud to welcome Dilma Rousseff, former president of Brazil, first female president of Brazil, a driver and major figure in the Workers' Party. We are, of course, keen to hear her analysis of the situation in Brazil today and her views on how Brazil can move beyond its current malaise to regain the leading position it has played in the world in the past decade. So I want to thank you. I want to welcome you to the New School, and I want to ask Professor Carlos Forment, Professor of Sociology and Director of the Janey Program in Latin American Studies, to say a word before we begin. Thank you very much.
I'll be even briefer, since I believe Will has really summarized the most important points. The main one I'd like to stress here is that we are, on behalf of the Janey Program in Latin American Studies, we extend really a warm, warm welcome to former President of Brazil, Dilma Rousseff, and also we would like to welcome all the members of her delegation who are here with us. This academic year, the Janey has organized and sponsored several seminars, workshops, and a conference on the current crisis in Brazil. Today's event is especially significant for the Janey program, and we are truly, truly honored and exceedingly pleased to have Dilma here with us. I would also like to thank all the members of the sociology department who have been really selfless and generous in helping us. And I would also like to thank Felipe Ramos, who of the Janey program, who helped with many, many of the logistical and administrative details of this conference. And there were many. The conference today has been co-organized with the Urban Democracy Lab of New York University. Its director, Gianpaolo Baiocchi, is here with us, and he will be introducing Dilma and say a few words in general about his own program. So if Gianpaolo is in, yes, there he is. Thank you.
Thank you, Carlos. Thank you, and I promise I will be the last introducer. A couple of things. So first of all, I wanted to extend a hand to all the people who put time and effort into organizing not only this event, but Dilma's visit to the United States, which I understand has been very productive. So thank you to everybody for all the effort. It's largely volunteer work. I wanted to welcome Dilma on behalf of the NYU Urban Democracy Lab. If you're curious about what we do, I invite you to go look at our webpage. But one of the things we do is we like to invite protagonists and people who innovate democracy in a meaningful way, and we encourage the kind of discussion that we're having today that is critical, sharp discussion across academic, political, and civic lines. What can I say to introduce Dilma Rousseff? Dilma Rousseff was the first woman elected to the president of Brazil. She was a democratically elected president of Brazil, received 54 million votes. Three times, Forbes magazine said she was one of the most powerful women on earth. She was the first woman to open a UN assembly session. And no doubt we're gonna talk about some of the important parts of her program in government. But I want to turn to a couple of other aspects of Dilma Rousseff's biography so that I can properly answer the question of why we want to speak with her today. Dilma Rousseff was part of the courageous generation of people, my parents' generation, who put their bodies and lives on the line to defend democracy, many of whom suffered torture, people were killed. But this was a generation that believed in many different ideological points of view, but fundamentally believed in building Brazilian democracy, and they believed in the capacity of the Brazilian people to follow them. Dilma Rousseff, sometimes it is forgotten, was very important in the administration of Alceu Colares, one of the first black mayors in Brazil and one of the first left-wing mayors of Brazil, elected in 1986. She played, again, a very important role in Alceu Colares' state government and in Olivia Dutra's state government with her innovative energy policies, which is what propelled her to Brasilia a couple of years later. We are no doubt going to talk about her program, and we're going to have an opportunity to discuss the impeachment process as it was. But to answer the question of why we should talk with Dilma Rousseff, not just us Brazilians in the audience, but also the young people and the activists here today who are on the streets wanting to do something about democracy as it seems to falter in this country. I had the opportunity recently to take NYU students to the Museu da Resistência, which is a museum in São Paulo to the victims of torture. And one of the things this museum does beautifully, painfully, is it reminds us that Brazil's democracy is actually very young, that reactionary forces, that authoritarian forces have not really gone away, and this is a phenomenon that's very recent. But it also reminds us of something else, that Brazil's democracy was essentially built by people of Dilma's generation. And if you look across Dilma's life, you think about what do people do, what does someone do to build democracy? You argue, you mobilize, you put your body on the line, you develop intelligent policies, you agree, you disagree, you win, and sometimes you lose, but you never stop fighting. Please welcome Dilma Vana Rousseff.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to say hello to Professor Neuburg, the director of New School. I'd also like to say hello to Carlos Forment and Nancy Fraser, professors of New School. I'd like to salute Professor Jean Paolo Paiocchi from New School University. For me, it's a pleasure to be here today at New School, and I feel very honored to speak in this auditorium who have had very important people here before, such as El Caso, from the thinker and philosopher Anna Haren. I would like to start saying that it's very clarifying what she said about the banality of evil. And I experienced the banality of evil in my life. In fact, the evil is banal. Not because it inflicts us in pain, death, loss of people from your family. It's banal because right by perversity, we have what we have in the dictatorship times, and when you violate democracy. I've lived through two coups in my life. The first one was during the military dictatorship, and I suffered the consequences of the biggest enclosing of the government in Brazil. And the second one was an impeachment without a crime of responsibility. That was one of the most important guarantees of democracy, which is the popular vote. The impeachment and the coup buried 54 million votes, and the constitution from 1988, the democratic constitution, that opened the process of democracy in Brazil and guaranteed social rights and political rights and civil rights. Hurting the Constitution happened because it was what the impeachment did without a crime of responsibility. The impeachment didn't have democratic support. And in my case, nowadays, my impeachment happened because of a process that respected the democratic rituals, but it frauded democracy because we didn't have constitutional basis for the impeachment, because we didn't have crime of responsibility in the three decrees that was related to 0.15% of the expenses, or the Safra plan, which was the credit plan and the offer of credit that the Brazilian government did for the agricultures, the small agricultures or the bigger agricultures in Brazil, in which the president does not interfere. So besides that, I was judged by something that I was not part of. It's very interesting to notice this flexibility when you actually want to use the law as a weapon, not only the traditional weapons that are anti-democratic tools, but the law can be used as something anti-democratic. So my impeachment process showed us this with clarity. So I'd like to tell you about the reasons of the parliamentary coup that hit Brazil last year. This parliamentary coup had two reasons. Amongst the several reasons, there is one that I'm going to start with that goes beyond this coup. There is an misogynous attitude behind the characteristics of the coup, which is very sexist. So they use symbolic use for women, for the figure of the man and the women. The women is very fragile and subject to emotional crisis, but a man is a whole, is a sensible and sensitive person. Women are dedicated to work very compulsively, but a man is an honest worker, a loyal worker. So a lot of these oppositions were thrown against me in the ideological combat in my government. This was the basic reason of the coup. The other reason was also not something basic of the coup, but it's present in this situation, in the political articulation of the coup leaders. It's about the matter of what they actually wanted the impeachment to produce. With me not in the picture, they would want to stop the investigation of corruption, and they thought it wouldn't interfere with the nucleus of the coup leaders. So it was a conversation between two senators was recorded. Actually, it was a very important senator that articulated the coup. His name was Romero Jucá, and one said to the other, "Well, look, it's necessary that she is impeached. Me. It's necessary that she's impeached because we need what we call stop the bleeding, just so we can stop that they continue the investigations. So that will stop the investigations from coming to us." So this is an element that we should understand to understand the democracy in Brazil. The strategic reason of the coup was another one. This first reason articulated the political segment of the coup leaders, PMDB and PSDB party, and also other political parties. But the soul, the articulator of the coup was not that. The soul of the coup was integrated by a strategy. It's about a clear strategy of framing of Brazil, an economic and geopolitical social framing of Brazil in neoliberalism that was stopped when President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva was elected in 2003. Because Brazil didn't complete this process that happened strongly in other countries, we had three main banks in Brazil, Caixa, and Rio State Bank and Brazil Bank. At the same time, we had preserved the state owned oil company Petrobras. We kept the policy of social inclusion and the tools that allowed the policies to happen and to distribute income and wealth in Brazil. So this was the goal of the coup. It's an author, Milton Friedman, which is a thinker, was reflecting about the conditions to implement the neoliberalism, and I think this is very interesting. He would say, you have to take advantage of a crisis and have a program for the afterwards of the crisis. You have what is politically impossible and the politically inevitable. The politically impossible was through the popular vote. And to have a program of a drop in the rights of Brazil at that moment. Privatization, very accelerated. Privatization of public patrimony. So now they want to sell the lands in Brazil. I refer to the fact that this program was defeated four times. For four times, this program was defeated. The last time it was defeated, it was clear that it was necessary to suspend the democracy in Brazil, just so we could have a hope of adopting it. So the politically impossible was approving democratically the neoliberal in Brazil. And the politically inevitable was, through an impeachment, get to create conditions to adopt the neoliberalism. It's interesting to assess what has been done through this period. In this period, we were able to get Brazil out of the hunger map, overcome extreme poverty, 36 million people. We had done education and health inclusion programs. We found out Brazilian wealth, which is the pre-salt layer, and we explored it. We explored this wealth and this rich. This richness is around 1,000 meters below the surface of the sea. It's a wealth that requires a very sophisticated technology because you have very high temperature at that depth and a very high pressure. Sometimes the temperature is very extreme. It could be extremely hot or extremely cold. In the beginning, in 2006, when we discovered it, they used to say that we were incapable of exploring this rich, this wealth. But up until I left, the pre-salt was equivalent to everything that we were able to obtain with petroleum in the last 100 years. So we were able to read 1,700,000 million barrels until I left. All this was to create enough, good enough conditions for this environment. But this was, but the situation of taking advantage of the economic crisis was added another component, which was the political crisis. I'm going to talk about the economic crisis. The theory about what happened in Brazil in the half of 2014 until I left is that the Brazilian government was broke, and it had broken the country. The country was broke. This doesn't have any real basis. It's interesting to notice that a country is only broke when you don't have reserves or resources to pay your external debt and your international creditors. We saw this happen in other countries such as Greece and other places. Brazil went through this. In the military dictatorship, the creditors organized themselves in the Club of Paris. The Monetary Fund made an intervention in the macroeconomic policy in Brazil. because we had the debt crisis at that time. At the end of the government of Fernando Henrique Cardoso, in the last 2 years of his government, we had the exchange crisis. In Brazil at that time, had approximately $14 million in reserve, and we had a debt of $16 million. When we came to the government, the monetary fund was in control of the Brazilian debt and financial expenses. So at that time, all the resources they went into paying the debt. So up until the moment that we paid the creditors and the monetary fund, which was in, if I'm not mistaken, at the end of 2005, beginning of 2006, we started to raise the amount of reserve that Brazil had. So we didn't have a debt with the monetary fund anymore, and I was there when this happened. It was the director and president of the monetary fund. And his last name is Rato. He's a Spanish economist. I think you know who he is. So we paid off our monetary fund at that time. From then on, we started to accumulate reserves in the government of President Lula and in my government. When I left the government, we had approximately, depending on the fluctuation in the exchange of the dollar, we had something between 378, 376 billions of dollars. Until that moment, we were the fifth or the sixth economy with the biggest reserve in a strong currency. So we had no probability or problem with payment of debt. It's good to say that Brazil is not a debtor. Brazil is a creditor. During the crisis of Brazil, it was necessary to create a wall of protection. So Brazil, Russia, India, and China, and South Africa, we lended a significant amount of resources. China was number one, and South Africa was the last one. Brazil, India, and Russia lended significant amount of money. So in this sense that Brazil is broke doesn't make any sense. It's actually the opposite. The international finances of Brazil have never been so stable. Therefore, if we follow the manual, if we follow the rule, it shouldn't be the Brazilian government that it's broke. The government, has the revenue of taxes, so it's impossible to say that we're going through economic crisis. So it's about the bills of the government that are broke. It's not the government that broke, but the government has a problem in administrating its fiscal sessions. And why? Because the government spent too much. It's it's not true that the expenses of the government were excessive. It's the opposite. If you draw a parallel, a historic parallel of the expenses and the personal expenses, you see that the expenses, they kept constant, in a constant basis. In relation to my period, it raises a little bit, the expenses raised a little bit, but especially when it comes to pensions and the Bolsa Família program and retirement, and also other services such as wealth and education. So this is the reality. In the last 2 years, when the international crisis of 2008 got to Brazil, through some currents that led this crisis to Brazil, we say that an international situation produced, with the deacceleration of the economy, a drop, a very big drop in the revenue in Brazil. So we had a drop of the commodities prices. Not because our budgets were dependent on commodities. No, we're actually a country that produces the pre-salt layer technology. We produce airplanes. We have a very big navy structure. We produce pharmaceutical products. So we have a very complex industrial technology. So what was the effect of the drop in the commodities price? So the big companies that are related to the commodities, they were responsible for giving the government some taxes. So if we had the commodities prices dropping, we also had the taxes of these companies dropping as well. So the prices of the commodities, they in 2006, they were similar to the prices of the commodities in 2009. So the crisis in 2008 in the United States affected a lot our political situation later on. Brazil then, in the last few years, had a very big deficit in relation to the United States. This changing the policy and the politics also had a very important factor. When the United States raised their interest rates, they also contribute in a decisive manner our inflation in Brazil with exchange rate. We have a positive effect, which is the rising in exportations, but we also have the negative effect, which is the inflation. Another effect is the deacceleration of the Chinese economy. And this also comes with some very serious problems, because they're not going back to growing 10%, and it was expected to grow around 7%. We also had a very big problem, which is a drought, the biggest drought in the last 10 years. And it's something that we hadn't seen in years in the southeast part of the country. And this meant a considerable rise in price of energy in Brazil, because we had to use the land.
I would like to say something to you. The proof that we broke Brazil is very clear. In June 24, 2016, if you remember, the UK left the European Union. When the UK left, everyone expected a high volatility in the market. The Brazilian government, which was already the coup government, sent a memo saying the following. They were 2 months old then. The illegitimate government sent a memo. What did the memo say? It was a memo about Brazil's situation. Quote, the Brazilian situation is of solidity and safety because the fundamentals are robust. Who is responsible for the robust developments? My government, not the illegitimate one. The main arguments utilized to prove that the fundamentals were robust were, first, the country has expressive volume of international revenues, and the income of international investments have been sufficient to invest more. The financial market is stable, which we do not control. Third, the national treasury, this is important, counts with a large liquidity. The federal public debt is composed primarily of titles in real and in Brazilian currency, which leaves no doubt for this. Brazil is ready to cross with safety periods of external instability. Unquote. That was not achieved by any legitimate government, even because nobody can build $380 billion in revenue in only 2 months. Nobody can make the public debt to have some leverage in 2 months. The reason behind the coup is of another. It is of securing not alterations in the economy, not adjustments in legislation. It is meant to secure a plan, a model of change. What are the large initiatives that the illegitimate government take? The first initiative that is obvious, besides closing the Ministry of Culture and in the policies directed towards women, besides these serious policies, others had more macroeconomic repercussions, direct and indirect. But the budget policy that they implemented was a straitjacket that froze for 20 years in real economic terms, that is for 5 presidential terms, since that each presidential term lasts 4 years. So for 20 years, meaning 5 presidential terms, the government will freeze the expenditures with health and education, while keeping expenditures with safety. No, it freezes those expenditures, primary, those nominally fall. So social assistance, Social Security also falls down. This is a constitutional amendment that was approved and brings two problems. The first one is the obvious one, that removes the poor lower classes from the budget, because those are the ones that need policies in education, health, and welfare. And they are the majority of the Brazilian people. They also remove these people from decision-making processes, because what is decided in a presidential election in any part of the world, here in the United States or in Brazil or in any democratic regime, presidential regimes in the world, when you elect a president, you elect him or her, giving him or her a term. And that term is meant to direct the expenses to whom? In what quantity? To which segments of society? It's important to remember that here in the United States, if I'm not mistaken, the budget is made in a department that is connected to the president. Because the budget is a central piece that defines the difference between the governments. When you do this for 20 years, when you freeze the cost for 20 years, you do two simultaneous actions. To execute an absolutely neoliberal policy, removing from the poor and increasing the social disparity, and at the same time, a policy of state advancement, because it hurts the essence of democracy, which is the popular vote. That is why the coup was implemented in Brazil. To fuel this desire, this political desire to have a neoliberal policy implemented. And then we have the retirement reform, social security reform. It comes from the thought of that we always have to change the social security in order to fit the social reality of the country. But we need to change the model of social security. They're not trying to equate the problem that our government increased the life expectancy of Brazilian population. Because when you help the poor with wealth distribution, education, and health, you necessarily decrease the mortality rate for diarrhea. And Bolsa Família, one of our programs, produced this in a very concrete way. We changed the life expectancy. And more than that, we also changed the afterlife. We increased life expectancy in 4.6 years. Sectors of the economy, like domestic labor, maids that had no rights before our terms now had some written laws that helped give them rights. The problem is that this is not an adjustment. Why is it not an adjustment? I give a very simple example. In the middle of this revolution, there's an item. Minimum retirement age of 60 years old. I'm not going to talk about the sexual labor division in Brazil. Women in Brazil don't have social equipment to guarantee her work during the time that she has kids and breastfeeds. Only for those categories of the higher income classes. But a hardworking woman does not have that structure, that support. I would like to remind you that the largest part of women in Brazil don't have the continuity of labor that men are allowed to in Brazil. Studies show that in average, a man spends 7 years. The Brazilian population, not just men, spends 7 years. Of course, if you take women in consideration, it's a little lot higher. 7 years in average, unemployed, or with informal labor for many reasons, or in a situation of autonomous labor without contribution, tax contribution. So that's about 7 years of these kinds of labor. And I'd like to suggest these criteria to show that we have changed this model. 65 years of tax contribution. We can discuss this, but that's not changing. It's a combination. 49 years of contribution. When we coincide 64 with 49 years of contribution, the person has the right to full retirement plan. if you need to add more years to add to the 49 years, it gets to 56 years. So the person needs to start working when he or she is 9 years old. What does that mean? It means that the person is never going to get full retirement plan, because it is impossible to have full retirement in this system. The full retirement plan has been taken away from the population. The proportional plans, in the case of women, studies show that 44% of women that are working today won't have access to retirement. Okay, now let's talk about the rural workers. Rural workers in Brazil, I'm not talking about the large agricultural business. I'm talking about the 70% of small agricultural businesses and agricultural workers that are responsible for 70% of the food that goes to Brazilians' tables. These workers have no income continuity. They have 9 months of income and 3 months of no income. Some of them have a different format of income distribution. But throughout the years, this is not just in mine and Lula's governments. Throughout the years, this was configured. The rural worker pays when he or she commercializes that production, and then he pays taxes. If you require the worker to pay every month and personalize the payment, you remove all of the workers from the IRS. It makes the IRS and taxes no longer viable. And then it makes proportional retirement impossible. You turn the Social Security system irrelevant. So you create a complementary system. That is perfect, but you can't just do that. You transfer a substantive part of the public Social Security. What's behind this reform is not the huge deficit. The deficit doesn't grow because of the situation. We have to adjust, but we also have to know that in a situation in which the drop in revenue, there's also a drop in contribution. When we had a stable situation in Social Security was when labor was increasing. So in 2014, we had the lowest unemployment rate ever at 4.8%. We had a stable situation. We had to execute some subsidies and add some transition time. And modify, as well as create almost automatic rules to adapt to each person's condition. That's no longer what's being done in Brazil. What is being done now is an accelerated creation of a private provident system that will remove a lot from Social Security in a country whose main anchor in terms of Social Security is retirement plan. The social security net in Brazil is composed of the following. It protects the elderly that have worked for their whole lives. Unemployment payments also helps elderly and poor people that are disabled. This is a continuing benefit conveyance program. It was specially geared towards the elderly poor population. But the population of the young population with children did not have a support system. Bolsa Família, one of our programs, was precisely this structure, geared towards poor young families with or without children, below the misery line. I conclude by saying that there is a clear determination in reducing the rights of Brazilians, not because of evil. Maybe there is a little component of evil and perversity. However, but adopting a conception that the government cannot simply just help the poor people. It can't. Besides that, in many other areas that occurs, for instance, selling lands to foreigners without any restriction is very dangerous. More than dangerous, it threatens the country's sovereignty. Nobody sells its own fertile lands, not in the world. The privatization of wealth, fantastic wealths. And you can't tell me that you have to privatize because our oil company is in debt. Someone who knows the concessions of oils in Brazil. No, I'm sorry. Not the concessions, but revenue sharing. The difference between concession and sharing. Concession, you don't know where the oil is. Sharing in the oil reserves, you know where the oil is. You know that the quantity is very large. And you know that the quality of the oil is from average to high. That's why a revenue-sharing regime, which is polygonal in the Continental Bay in Brazil. Besides that, we have a high risk in the question of labor rights and legislation. Next to neoliberalism and finance capital, the subjection of productive capital to the finance capital, you have a lot of consequences, which is besides the inequality, the worsening of working conditions. Brazil is outsourcing labor. By outsourcing, you no longer pay the rights to workers. So it transforms the individual worker into a corporation. This word in Portuguese is pejotização. So we have a situation of huge regressive possibilities. And then here comes a contradiction in which the Brazil finds itself in. They can either, who is they? The articulators of the coup, and the ones that control the majority in Congress. These people either deliver all of the promises, which I have stated here very briefly, and make themselves look illegitimate before the population because these reforms don't have the backing of the population. And that is increasingly problematic with the 2018 elections coming up. Or they lose the support of media, of the press, and of the market because they won't deliver the reforms that both the market and the popular and the press expect from them in exchange for support for the coup. That is a contradiction. The contradiction between delivering the promises and losing the population backing, or not deliver the promise and lose the support of the media and the market. It is a serious political contradiction amongst many others that I shouldn't make more explicit. So to conclude, so we can move on to questions, I would like to say the following. Brazil has a problem, which is very serious and affects many countries in the world. Brazil is moving towards an accelerated process of neoliberalism, radicalizing its finance capital, returning to the state of a very unequal country. And something is very complicated. The more a country does not see for its population's needs, it becomes irrelevant to that population. When a government becomes irrelevant, there's a tendency to turn the policies irrelevant and to turn politics irrelevant. And it creates a vacuum. In this vacuum, you have patriotic saviors, policies that aim at an enemy to implement other things. A group of monsters are created that come out of the box. And politics take a big risk. In Brazil, after 1988, we had just built a process of redemocratization beyond the positions that each segment, the progressives, the conservatives, had. We created a democratic center despite our differences. And that center was very important for government ability or mentality. The process was finally broken. And until I left, by the time I left, Brazil had 25 different political parties in the Congress. 25 parties cannot create 25 different policies for Brazil. You might have 4, 3, 2, or 5, but 25 is too much. If we have a fragmented democratic center that made possible that a part of it, especially the most conservative, most extremely conservative part of it, hegemonized the center. It construed a process of hegemony in the center. And that is clear with the former Speaker of the House, Eduardo Cunha, that built this process. And so we have a problem in Brazil. A democratic center, the remainders of a fragmented democratic center with a hegemonic conservative base, and we have a fragmentation. I don't think, I'm a person who doesn't believe that you can make isolated institutions responsible for undue practices. I know it's hard to translate into English the word physiologic. These practices that we know of exchanging positions, exchanging members and benefits, which creates a system wholly polluted, this system. That's not the political parties, it is a system. In the system, you have some clauses, some requirements. The most incredible is that two of them are democratic, and the one is not democratic. The non-democratic one is a requirement that's normal of political systems that requires that there is a barrier clause. What does that mean? It is when a party turns into a party. The party becomes a party when it has a number of congressmen, of senators, a number of votes throughout the country. If it has two democratic clauses, one that gives access to political campaigning funds and free television time, air time, that allows a party to maintain itself with public resources. Now they want the system not to be a physiologic system, but a corrupt one. Brazil needs to go through a fundamental political reform. We have been defending this since 2013, that a political reform comes out of an exclusive constituent . The second question is that we have a meeting scheduled with democracy in Brazil in October. At this moment, we will elect the president, and we need that election so that we can do something that's essential. We can't rekindle the dialogue between the different political veins without having a fundamental democratic basis, which is the popular vote. We need to have an elected person over which there's no doubt of his or her legitimacy. There is a barrier today. Those that have defended the illegitimate governments have defended that illegitimacy. We can't.
It passed a democratic pact that's done through the secret election of the president of a country. And we have to care for this choice. We are not naive. Nobody did the coup to lose it afterwards. So the democratic process in Brazil must be really democratic. It cannot be the object of last-minute changes or of attempts of changing the game rules while it's still being built. So I refer to the parliamentarism policies that were defeated already twice, also perpassing other matters such as the president that was re-elected being able to be a candidate again. And we have the president, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. So in Brazil, we're going to make a pact. And this pact is that nobody doubts the result of the elections. So now I'm going to finish my talk. We need that these elections allow everyone to stop, to think, and then dialogue. Elections wash and dry our souls and allow us to meet and rediscover democracy again. All other ideas that tell us to have a dialogue just looks like the Asterix and Obelix story, which is like this. There's a centurion on a horse thinking and meditating while the horse is strolling through the Gaia occupation. And he was saying, I don't understand these people. We invade, we destroy, we capture and rape their women. We had a very strict attitude with them. And then when we call them for a dialogue, they don't want a dialogue.
Let me escort you to your chair. We are now going to join in the stage Gianpaolo, Nancy, and Lance, and they will initiate the discussion, then it will be open to the public, and we can go until roughly, say, 6 o'clock or so, and so we're ready.
Is this microphone on?
Yes.
Okay. Well, it's terrific to hear this very inspiring talk with such a complex, multi-layered explanation of the coup in encompassing misogyny, the attempt of a corrupt class to protect itself from criminal investigation, an agenda of privatization and neoliberalization of the economy, all culminating in a worsening of the situation for the majority of the Brazilian people and, of course, the shredding of democracy. Great to hear this very powerful account and this very inspiring and, to me, absolutely convincing conclusion. No democracy, no dialogue. Great. So, so we now are going to have a dialogue. I mean, maybe we still have some democracy here in the United States. So we're going to assume we do, and we will start our dialogue with Professor Lance Taylor, who's going to pose a first question to President Rousseff, and then Gianpaolo Baiocchi.
Okay, well, let me begin with one philosophical observation and then really ask two quick questions about the Lula-Dilma government in Brazil. The observation is that is it possible for a leftist, progressive, social democratic government to function in the world today? I mean, if you look around the world, you see Hollande in France was more or less backed away from anything serious. Schulz in Germany is now advocating austerity. And is it even possible, given the situation, for social democracy to function? And if so, what has to be done? Now, two specific observations about Brazil. In the beginning of President Dilma's administration, there was a fiscal issue, and there would have to be some kind of fiscal adjustment. How should that have been done? One can think of raising taxes on having more progressive taxation to support people at the bottom of the income distribution. A welfare state had been created, but it was fragile, and steps could have been taken to try to sustain it. Second question is, what about the rating agencies? Dilma was talking about the IMF and the imposition of austerity and that kind of thing. At the beginning of her second administration, Brazil was under a lot of pressure from the international rating agencies in terms of, usual business about too expansionary government. And so how do you stop that? And why, when in her first year of her administration, did she appoint a reactionary Chicago boy to be the Minister of Finance? That's it.
Bom, eu vou começar pela primeira, a primeira pergunta. Você podia me
Could you repeat the first question? Because you made three questions. If it's possible, a social democratic policy in today's world. I think that it is important for us to clarify that is a question that no one can answer because we don't pretend to have exhausted the necessary action for Brazil to face all of its different inequalities, privileges, and exclusions that the country had. In a ladder with many steps, we might have climbed the first and second steps. It's not easy to do this even in 10 years. We were unable to do something that I think is referring to your second question, which is the question of wealth distribution, which is different distribution of income. If you consider the income distribution as a function of increased taxation, every time Brazil faced taxing capital gains, we lost. We could not approve such measures. Brazil is the only country in the world, next to Estonia, that does not tax dividends. We couldn't pass taxing inheritance. And it was rejected what we requested. The problem that was not under our jurisdiction, which was to tax inheritance in a determined moment, it was the taxation of large fortunes. So this is a problem that Brazil will have to face. We have in the world a debate, which is a debate of taxation. That is a function of neoliberalism. To tax capital gains lowers investment. It decreases interest rates and positive tax. That is a question that Brazil has to face, because there's no way to proceed in this process without the necessary resources to distribute wealth, which has to do with houses, lands, and some fixed goods that are essential and symbolic for the population. We can't create policies that are effective without treating the question of wealth in Brazil. The crisis is a moment of distributive conflict. During my impeachment process and during the crisis that was created, a group of businessmen and women represented by the Federation of Industries in São Paulo and its president, created a yellow pact whose dimensions were gigantic, about 6 meters high. He put this yellow duck in the center of a large São Paulo avenue, symbolizing the following: I do not want to pay for this, pagar o pato, or pay for the duck in Brazil. It means I do not want to pay for the taxes that are required to leave the crisis. This duck remained every day on the avenue during the impeachment process, including when the illegitimate government arrives in the power. One of the first meetings that he had is with the duck representatives, who went there to charge him, to ask him not to pay for the duck. What is behind the duck? Behind the whole duck question, besides being laughable, it is very serious. It is an aversion to taxes which is imposed on Brazil. Brazilians pay very high taxes, comma, yes. Who? The working class and the middle class? No. Who? The business class. and the classes that have large income on capital gain in dividend form or titles or investments. Those don't pay taxes. So taxation is high, but for those who suffer the most with that high, with that rate. And it's light for those that have capital gains. I believe that one of the sources of inequality is the lack of taxation in all the countries in the world, of the capitalist world, that today do not tax capital gains, especially from finance capitals, which is extremely significant. That is why I believe it is strategic for Brazil to discuss tax reform. The second, third, or fourth steps in this ladder are an inexorable step to change the distribution, the concentration of wealth in the hands of few. Some clauses of information thwart the distribution of information of what really goes on. Being a social democrat today is a very hard job. Very difficult, very contradictory. We have a path that's not to run from anything, it's to confront amplifying the democratic debate. Because when the duck went to the streets in the Paulista Avenue, there were no protests against that duck in Brazil. Maybe today, if that duck comes back, the protest would be generalized. But when it happened, it wasn't generalized. Oh, something else. Why did we choose a Chicago boy, which is what you have called the economist Joaquim Levy? I would like to explain very clearly what happened there. We have made three adjustments in Brazil before this one that was done in 2015, 2016. The first one we did was 2003, 4, and 5. This is a difficult policy adjustment because the inflation hurts and the exchange crisis can kill. We were facing an exchange crisis. 2004, it was still difficult. In 2005, we were able to reach a point in which the pro-coup opposition built the following expression: let's let them bleed, because then we can win the election in 2006. After that, we made another adjustment in 2008, in 2009, then 2010. And in 2010, the economy got a boom and grew 7%. At the turn of 2011, we made another adjustment to reduce the inflation, because it was beginning to be explosive. So we have a lot of experience in adjusting inflation. And when I say us, I mean it because I was the chief of staff of President Lula, which is a position that coordinates all of the cabinet. What did we learn from that? We learned that it was important, and it had worked in the three previous times. It was important to impose that adjustment, which redefined where our expenses lied. We also proposed rising taxes. One of those tax increases that we asked for was the taxing financial transactions. Besides giving lots of revenue, it thwarts fiscal fraud. Because when you tax the financial transaction, the IRS in Brazil knows exactly who is paying what to whom. We proposed 0.38%, I believe, in taxing transactions. But that created a generalized revolt, rebellion, led by the media and obviously the sectors that would be affected by this taxation. Why some sectors would be affected and others no? Very simple. Because income and retirement, a certain level of income is exempt from this taxation. The people who would pay IOF, the transactional tax, would be those more elevated financial companies. One of the functions of the yellow duck was to keep us from charging this tax. The person who led the macroeconomic policy that made it work was the current Minister of Finances in Brazil. The person who leads the government is the nucleus that creates policies. What we proposed was an adjustment in tax to increase our revenue. We believe that some people would have some restriction for a year and a half, and we would keep the costs, the social costs with Bolsa Família, educational programs, the 63 million people that we have helped with the more doctors programs. We have kept our social policies. But without believing that the miraculous austerity costs is true. Because it has an end. You need to increase revenue. There's no miracle here. What is the ideological question behind my impeachment? It was executed because they wanted to criminalize my fiscal policy. They criminalize my fiscal policy. Because it's not possible to create an anti-cyclic policy. Because we can't. What would the rest of the European austerity say to the fifth or seventh largest economy in the world? We could have worked. Because you have to combine an adjustment in costs with an increase in revenue. It's not a crazy change. It is to find the revenue that is tied to taxation, to progressive taxation, not regressive taxation, like it was a tradition in Brazil. So I believe that Brazil would not be at this level of recession if in 2015 they had approved what we had proposed. On the contrary, the political crisis had already begun. So what did they do? Because the political crisis had already begun. You might remember that the press named it a bomb policy. So a policy that would explode. Instead of reducing the cost, they increased the cost. Those who are in the government today, they increased the costs at absurd levels at a moment when the country faced a crisis. So I believe the essential factor behind the economic crisis in Brazil could be predicted. It would have happened. We avoided it for 6 years. It was coming. But it would have been a much smaller crisis if it hadn't had on top of it a political crisis, because they started proposing an impeachment process only three months after I had been elected. So when they saw that I had been elected, meaning it was the fourth consecutive election that they had lost, they changed from the democratic possibility to a coup d'etat certainty.
I'm going to give the floor now to Professor John Paolo Biocchi from NYU to pose another question.
Thank you. Wonderful so far. And I'm going to follow up a little bit on the yellow duck story, which is this. I agree very much that the right has become hegemonic in Brazil today, controlling ideology, media, public discourse. But I wanted to ask about the other side, meaning why aren't, what is the left doing? And in this moment, a lot of people in Brazil, as you know, are rethinking and questioning and doing a self-criticism of the left. What do you see as a possible futures for this left bloc to compete against this right-wing hegemony in Brazil?
Olha, eu acredito.
Well, I believe that it's impossible not to have a center in Brazil. I think it's essential to realize that we not only have the left, but it's necessary to have a center, a progressive center. In a country so diverse and complex such as Brazil, it's impossible to be governed without a composition of the center and the left. Besides that, I also think that the left-wing party, we were defeated, but this defeat should be used by us to look for a way of amplifying the democracy. Experience shows us that the democracy strengthens transformation in Brazil. I believe in this passage of responsibility from one generation to another. And I think it's important in these next few years in Brazil. First, we will have to face the consequences of the coup. We will have to restructure a way of economic growth in Brazil. And overall, inequality reduction path in Brazil. Overall, we have to build the political participation of Brazilian. There's something very dangerous happening in Brazil, which is saying that the responsible for all that are the political parties. Politics are something ugly and dirty. Well, I ask myself the following. We have an Occident and a Western transition. There is no democracy. They were born together. The democracy was born with politics. You can't have democracy if you don't have politics. Because politics, I'll get to the parties. So the politics are the way through which we think in the interest of all, in a society, in a community, or a segment. Politics and democracy were born together. The Greek used to say, the politics think in the general interest, and the economy thinks in the private interest, in a specific interest. In this meaning, we have a challenge. That is, the political parties, they're very, very important. And the political parties that have programs, that have debates, that have projects, you can have different ideas. It's okay. You can have an opposition. But you have to have parties, because if you don't, in a country with 200 million people, you don't have this conversation, this dialogue. How can a dialogue with people from Monteiro, which is a city in the state of Paraíba in Brazil, how do I talk to them? So the party, having different political parties, is a precondition to democracy. Having a pact in Brazil is something traditional from the country. We started having pacts when we changed from hierarchy to democracy in Brazil. This is part of the emergency of the extreme right wing in Brazil. Well, the intolerance, the hate, and this type of action is typical of the growth of the extreme right-wing party. And it was not used in Brazil. It was not very usual and traditional in Brazil. And it was not a political tradition in Brazil or here. But now it's common in Brazil, in Europe, and everywhere. I fear for democracy very much. Without political parties, and with this tendency to criminalize politics in Brazil, and criminalize it in a way that you think that politics are not something legitimate that you do, you only transform the political possibility to an elite, and you have very serious consequences.
For questions or comments from the audience, I'm sorry that it's hard for me to see hands from up here, but I do see one right there in the third row back. Yeah. You'll need a microphone. Microphone.
Hello. Okay. Well, I'll start with a question here. Primeiramente, fora Temer. Eu vou fazer minha pergunta em português.
I'm going to ask in Portuguese.
I'm going to ask my question in Portuguese. But I need to draw attention to a silence in your speech, which is the relation to your government, Odebrecht, and the corruption as an something in the Workers' Party. And it's clear that the media and the judiciary are partial, which is very clear. But besides that, I don't want to convince myself to vote for the Workers' Party anymore. So the dynamic of the Workers' Party, you were talking about transferring the power from generation to generation. but we don't see a renovation in the Workers' Party.
I would like to say what I think about this process of corruption, okay? I'll start. I believe that the question of combating corruption is very important, so much so that in 2013, I sent to Congress a law of combating criminal activities, criminal organizations, that defined the statute of plea bargains, which regulated plea bargains and allowed plea bargains. It was this law that better qualified something that already existed but wasn't very clear, to the point that you didn't see that in the past. You didn't see the criminalization of the corrupt person, only of the corruption. So the corrupt would be ignored, amongst other things, because it wasn't just for corruption. The law for criminal organizations was meant to tackle any kind of criminal organizations, drug trafficking, embezzlement, money laundering, or what have you. I believe, and it's important to say this first, the saying that we've never seen this much corruption in Brazil compared with any other society in Brazil is extremely false. I'll say this first, because the largest history of corruption in the last years was the 2008 crisis. Nobody here is innocent. You have a very large subprime crisis. This crisis criminalized, I don't know whom or where, but I believe that one of the important things from this is to criminalize the corrupt individual. Be him or her the CEO of a company, because it's not the policy that is wrong. They both have to be criminalized. Not even the parties. Neither the parties nor the companies themselves, institutions, need to be demolished. I don't believe any bank responsible, besides the Lehman Brothers, responsible for the subprime crisis has been destroyed. I don't believe that happened. I haven't heard anyone asking to destroy any companies that participated in any process of corruption. And there aren't few of them. There are many. If you see the last concession from Petrobras to gas licensing, you can Google corruption. You will see that these construction companies, some of them, not to say most of them, either had some administrative process or judicial process involving corruption. Either paid a fine, the executives have been arrested or not, it depends on the country. And the country remains, keeps its income and its salaries. That's also true to political parties. Political parties must survive. The politicians that committed those mistakes are the ones that need to pay for that. They have done of everything. I'd have no bank account in the exterior. No one can say that I have been corrupt. Recently, I'm going to say this story, tell this story, because it's very illuminating. And if you want to research it, you can find it. Recently, for 1 year, a whole year, one of the it was said that my chief of staff had said that You either contribute to the campaign or you will have no contract. And then, they were very stressed out. And I was, because it was my campaign for a whole year. The corrupt, who was a CEO of a company, was called to speak at a trial and answer when that donation had been done, had been made. He was saying that he was made to donate because he was threatened if otherwise. The defense, you didn't know when the fact had happened, when it had happened, how it had happened, and how. It said it was in this day, it was given in this day for the Workers' Party, and a personal nominal check was deposited. So we went after that, investigated, to find a check and the amount of money. It was the electoral court process that's currently going on. The money had been deposited to PMDB, and the check was nominal to current President Temer. So the court is tending towards erasing this testimony. And he is now saying it wasn't a bribe. It was a bribery for us, but since it was no longer for Workers' Party, but for the opposition party, it is no longer a bribe. So we ask them to archive the plea bargain. So I'm telling you that because I will not accept accusations that I have been bribed or that I have accounts, bank accounts in foreign countries. I want to be proved that I knew about corruption, because anything that I found out about in terms of corruption, I have thwarted.
A woman next, here please.
Thank you so much. I've been a public defender for 10 years. Eu sou defensora pública há 11 anos. Eu vi tudo que aconteceu.
I saw everything that happened in Brazil. The Bolsa Família program, the first families having children, the poor and the black leaving the small cities in Brazil. You just opened the decree that you see it's the combat against corruption. But now we are talking about the social and economic rights. Because this philosophical idea that we don't need the government started here. But now when life gets difficult for everyone, then we start asking ourselves, do we need the government? I can't believe that the corruption is this stage for one of the most philosophical questions, which is, where do our taxes go? If 2018, we have President Lula again, I will be there and I will vote for him because I saw the change in Brazil. I would like to thank you very much, President Dilma, because being such an important figure for women, and I don't want constant changes happening in Brazil with the banks and the taxes just raising by 500%. My name is Leonardo, and I'm from Columbia University. My question goes in two dimensions. Thank you very much for being here, having a dialogue with us. Congratulations for the organization of the event. And I'd like to have my question in two dimensions. The first one is of the presidentialism of coalition in Brazil. And the other one is for the process of political decision in Brazil. It's very hard to have a government in Brazil, to govern in Brazil, without the logic of the coalition presidentialism. That the government of the Workers' Party and also other governments were inserted into this logic. Something that draw my attention is when you have our current president, the Michel Temer, as the articulator of the dialogue with the Congress. This was like you were showing your neck to Dracula, and I think the current president looks like Dracula. This drew my attention a lot. And my question, if you, president, regretted this decision and another one, if you had to go through like an auto-critic or auto-subversion, an auto-assessment, if you had to evaluate your own self-critic, in a decisive point of view, what would you change? You don't have to say more than 3, 2, or even 1. But with mistake, we learn a lot. And if you could say, well, yeah, that was my mistake, or this was my mistake, you could teach us a little bit. Thank you very much. I can go. Yeah. Why? Why, guys? Let him talk. It's a very good question. Petronilli, your name. You know, this is what I think. First, I think it's not trivial. I think it's not essential. It's more difficult than you think. Much more. Presidentialism of coalition was something imposed by the model that was created in 1988. We didn't have another regime before that. And how did that work? You had the democratic center, or you had the progressists, or you had the conservative. So this is what happens since 1988. The democratic center, the traditional democratic center, was PMDB, who had Ulysses Guimarães as a big representative. And you have the democratic blocs. And you can disagree with their political views, but nobody can say that they weren't Democrats. And they were even responsible for the Constitution in 1988. There was, at the same time, a much simpler process and project of government. With this development, of course, you had more and more political parties. So the coalition had as a goal a majority. And you had the majority going to the government. In France, you elect the president, and then in 2 months later, you elect the Congress. And then you allow conditions for the president to form his majority and propose the governability. In case of Brazil, what happened? Let's get since Fernando Henrique. He needed three parties to have his simple majority, four to have his absolute majority. Lula needed, it varied from his first term and second term, but he needed four, he needed six. But then if he needed eight, he went to 12 to have a constitutional change. I needed to have a simple majority from 12 to 16, and I needed 20 to have a two-thirds of a majority. This shows us that there is an increasing factor of disorganization, of the political system in Brazil. The fragmentation implodes the presidentialism of coalition, and it makes it a challenge, a very big challenge, and a challenge in which you waste your time by having the creating a majority. In fact, he wouldn't have made a lot of difference if Temer was in or out. Officially, it used to be easier to control. Having him with me, it was easier to control what he was doing than what he was doing behind the curtains. But I don't think this is a good answer, I'm going to be honest with you. I think that we had a problem and we couldn't solve it. And I think the problem is still here. But just to finish, in 2013, we proposed the exclusive component that was the reform in Brazil. My constituent was buried, was ignored. And what I tell you, I think that for any president, whoever he is, you have to transform the Brazilian political system. It's not good enough for governability.
Recently, I answered many questions in respect to the current government in the United States, as well as the Obama administration. I would like to say, first of all, that as a president, I couldn't speak about any other government. To externalize my opinion was never an option. With this current president, even less so. I could express my opinion about any political leadership in Brazil, but I shouldn't give an opinion about any political leadership in another country.
Thank you very much. The person who really has made all of this possible. And I've left him to the very end because he really does deserve not one, not two, perhaps three rounds of applause. And that's my friend Diogo Santana. Okay, thank you everyone. And again, it's been an honor, a delight, and I hope we can have you visit us again. Thank you so much. Thank you.